Okay, good afternoon. I'll talk about Bergen, which is a medieval town at the coast of western Norway. It was founded in 1070, according to written sources, and developed into the main town of Norway during the 12th century. It is surrounded by a lot of or quite large area with both land resources, but also the coastal area, which is important for transport, and which made this made the base also for that the town could be so important, because it controlled during medieval time the trade along the coast of Norway. Northern Norway had to go into Bergen before they could have contact with other foreign countries. It became part of the Hanseatic League and was the northernmost office in this trade organization. In Bergen there has been a lot of archaeological excavations, and the first big one was after a fire in the northern area of the medieval town in 1955. But at that time, botanical remains were only collected when they saw it, as a big remains, which they saw, nutshells and some cherry stones and plums and so on. So it was not until the 1970s that we started with more regular collaboration between archaeologists and botanists, and the natural sciences took part also in the excavations and sampling. And also from the 70s we have got a lot of new pollen diagrams, so I'll start with talking a little bit about the development in the surroundings of the town. We have a big lake, some 20 kilometers south of the center of the town, and the pollen diagram from this site have been used to reconstruct the vegetation development, also the vegetation cover in different time periods. Then we have used a new methodology, the landscape reconstruction algorithm, it's called. It's developed by Shinya Sugita, and by using this, it's possible to transform the pollen percentages into vegetation cover. We still don't get the perfect picture of the vegetation in different time periods, but it's closer to reality than the pollen percentages. And what we see here is that between AD 250 and 7050, the forest is clear. You see, there is a stepwise opening. The green is forest, so it gets less and less forest, but especially after 250 AD. And in medieval time, we have the maximum heather cover in the area. And heather was very important along the coast. The heathlands, they were used for whole year grazing, and that meant that people could have more grazing animals. They probably needed that, and that's what is reflected in those curves. And we think that the increase we see in the Viking Age may be connected to the need for wool for the sails on the Viking ships. And then when it comes to medieval time, it probably also reflects the need for food, also meat, to the town, the increasing population in town, which need food. The pattern we see around Bergen is also found along the whole coast of Norway. We have used the same methodology to reconstruct the vegetation development. And to the right, you see some selected taxa, and the darker the color, the more of that taxa. And you see that for Kaluna, it's especially in the northern part of the area. We should have something to point. But it's in the north that we have the really high value. So it shows this importance of the heathlands in that northern part. But we also see that there is a decrease in the deciduous forest that was probably nearly completely cleared for agriculture. And we see the large extension of meadows, pastures, and cereal fields. So it was agricultural area outside the town, both north of Bergen and south of Bergen. And this opening of the landscape is also reflected in drawings from the town. We don't have drawings older than the 16th century, but it shows that the surroundings were grazing areas. And we have also some pollen data from a lake just outside. You see on the right hand side there is a small lake coming in, and that indicates that there were cultivation outside the town in medieval time. But the longest core we have is from what was earlier a marine basin in the northern part of the town, behind this harbor area. And that shows three types of deposits. In the bottom, we have a marine sand and gutta, and then we have sand with a lot of wood chips. And on top of that, we have this typical organic waste, which we get in the medieval towns, with a lot of mosses, wood chips, nutshells, and all this organic material. And when we look at the pollen composition in these, you see that in the bottom layer, we have the normal, it's grasses and it's rumex, ranunculus comes in, showing grazing areas in the prehistoric time period. But then, when we come to medieval time, it's something completely different. We get species like Vicia faba, we get a lot of cereals compared to what we have in the bottom layers. We have papave, helianthemum, and also myrica is very common. And I have forgotten to write, I see on the right hand side, the most common species of these is Centaurea cyanus. That's curved there. And you see that is absent from the lower layers. What does this show? And of course it doesn't show the vegetation surrounding this bay. It is the waste that has been thrown into the earlier basin. And this is an illustration made by James Gray. It's back to 1982, but I think it quite well shows the situation where we can have local pollen, we can have regional pollen, but it's this pollen coming with the plants that have been used, and also the pollen adding to these plants that have been used, which can dominate some of the deposits. And that is what is the case in this case, I think. And he also investigated some grains and chaff and straw of cereals, and found that they contained a lot of pollen grains, both from the species investigated, but also from the species growing together with the cereals, the weeds growing there. And in Bergen, or in the area surrounding Bergen, we have now investigated several countryside contexts with cultivated fields. And this is sites where we have samples from the late Viking Age. We don't have so many from the medieval time, but it gives the same pattern. And what is especially important is that we see very clearly, we have both pollen data and macro remains, and what are the common weeds in this area. And Centaurea cyanus and papaver is not found on the countryside of our region. So these species tells us about import of cereals to the town. And according to written sources also, cereals were an important import product to the town. So papaver and Centaurea cyanus, those are okay, they are weeds in the cereal fields. I have a bit more problem with helianthemum. It's not growing in Norway at all, but it's found in several of the samples. So it must have been growing in the vicinity of the areas where the cereals comes from, I think, or from some other plant material that we are not aware of yet. Because it shows the contact, at least, with some other countries. And also Vicia faba was imported to Bergen, and that is very common in these samples. And showing, at least in the start, some foreign trade. Myrica, on the other hand, is growing outside Bergen. It's very common there. It's used for a lot of purposes and was an important beer spice before hops, and also, in fact, partly simultaneously with the hops later on. And we found that in large quantities. So that shows the utilization of the near surroundings of the town. And we had a network project, Hansa network project, looking at plant material from medieval time in Germany, Poland, Estonia, Finland, Sweden, Denmark, and Norway. And what we could see was that we had fewer species present in Bergen than especially in Poland, Germany. That was the pattern also in the other Scandinavian countries. But what was very common in all our samples, and if we look at the number of contacts that are now included in, or was included in that project, we see that the berries, which could was growing just outside the town, they could collect and could trade or had connections, networks with the hinterland. They were very common, present in 20-30% of the samples or the contexts that were investigated. There is one berry, Rubus chamaemorus, which also can show trade with northern Norway. It's very common in the north, and we know that it was transported the whole coast down and also from, in fact, Norway to the Mediterranean. There are written sources telling about this on Sicily, for instance. But then, in addition to this, in quite many samples, we have We have Vitis, Ficus, and Juglans. And that shows the import to the town from distances far south of Norway. Juglans, or walnut, is a bit underrepresented because it's present as single fine in very many contexts, and we don't know the age of it, and therefore they are not included in these tables. But we see how people used had contacts both on this long distance and also in the shorter distances to the near countryside. And what is very commonly found in the town is hazelnuts. We have thick layers of hazelnuts. But when we look at the pond diagrams, so that upper there to the left, where we have tried to reconstruct vegetation cover, the pond diagram I showed first, that shows that there are nearly no Curilus left in medieval time in the surroundings of Bergen. And also a local diagram down to the right shows that it was present around Bergen, but it's not in the quantity that could have contributed to all these hazelnuts which we find in Bergen. So there it's connections to some fjord areas in a bit longer distance from the town. And we know also that it was a very important export from Bergen, both in medieval time and later. So we see this mixture of local and foreign trade. And I think this pot from Bergen from the 16th century summarized a bit of that. It was found in just some waste deposits out in the harbor area, and we found it was so the dominant species in this was figs, a lot of seeds of figs, but also that crowberry, strawberry, cloudberry, raspberry, all these local species were also present. But then we also analyzed the pollen, and that was dominated by cereals, and there were also a lot of Caluna vulgaris, which is a common species in the honey. So we see that the seeds and the pollen gives very different patterns, or they complement each other. And very often in these medieval towns, we it's only seeds that are analyzed. But I think it's very important that we analyze both the pollen and the seeds to get a better representation of what is present. Yeah, so that was what I had planned to say. Thank you.